So we reached out to CSUMB, to their admin folks, and we set up this program. And lo and behold, we've been blessed with fantastic graduate students. We have Sean Noble assessing user impacts on Point Lobos in terms of looking for trails, trail condition, bluff erosion, sediment discharge points into the SBS, aka the ocean. And he did a presentation and final report. Elizabeth Cope was looking at wildlife disturbance and wildlife studies in the reserve, and that effort is still continuing, although she graduated and gone on to bigger and better things. We now have Erica Senek and Erica Riley charging that effort forward. And then through the process of interacting with CSUMB over the course of the last 2 years, there was always someone kind of on the side who was expressing interest in what we were doing, and that was truly in the field. And I have to say, her interest, her perseverance paid huge dividends. I'm so thrilled with what she's been able to accomplish here. That very impressive. Her work is comprehensive. It's very well done, very well thought out, with very little direction, and I apologize for that, because I am busy, but that's no excuse. But we've been just really lucky to have Julia Fields here, and she's a graduate student out of the Applied Marine and Watershed Science Master's Program at CSUMB, and she expressed an interest in mapping the vegetation and the weeds at Point Lobos. So, and the plant communities also. So she just did a really excellent job, and I really hope that we can foster this relationship. Even if you graduate, I'm hoping you can. The last one's not off your head yet.
Even if she graduates?
When? She's going to be graduating soon. A month or two. You may. She's a hot commodity. I'm sure a lot of other people are like, but people aren't too. There's more to be done, a lot more to be done. So, without any further ado, I'm going to introduce Julia Fields. This is part of her graduate presentation. So, welcome to you.
When the reserve was first established, and this was used in the homestead work. created by Dr. James Barry, who is a state parks plantecologist, and he used a combination of remote sensing and field techniques to map the vegetation, and this was also included in the 1979 general plan. Now we also have an interesting study by professors at UC Riverside, specifically Dr. Richard Minnick and Dr. Michael Hamilton, and they actually acquired aerial photos from the USDA that dated back to the 1920s, and then they used stereo cameras to map the vegetation. And unfortunately, I haven't been able to track down the images or pictures from this report, so if you know anything about that, please let me know. I know it was a contract with Dr. Barry, who was working as a state parks ecologist here, but we do have the tables, so we at least know the area that each plant community represented, even if we don't know exactly where they were located. So Pueblos really is a special location. It has many unique habitats in a very small space. It's been described as the greatest meeting of land and water in the world, and also the crown jewel of the state park system. So I want to walk you through just a few of the plant communities that I was focusing on for this project. First, of course, you can't talk about Pueblos without talking about the Monterey Cypress. The reserve was basically established to protect this special plant community. And Pueblos has one of two remaining natural stands of Monterey Cypress in the world, and the other is the Pescadero Pine. Pueblos also has a lot of Monterey pine, and some of that is based on close by oak forest. And this is, Monterey pine is another special plant community. This is one of three natural locations of Monterey pine. The other include Año Nuevo, which is north of Santa Cruz, and then San Simeon State Beach to the south of us. And the understory vegetation in Monterey pine forest includes shrubs like California lilac, monkey flower, coffeeberry, and then poison oak is everywhere. And there are also shade-loving grasses and herbs like California canary grass, blue wild rye, sedges and rushes, blackberry, and hedgenow. Another dominant community in Pueblos is the coastal scrub. And this includes species like coyote brush, poison oak. You can actually see California sagebrush is in the foreground here. These yellow flowers are probably lizard tail. Also poison oak. And these are species that are especially adapted to survive summer drought and also to collect moisture from fog. Another special plant community of Pueblos are the coastal prairies. And these have native grasses such as purple needlegrass, blue wild rye. What you see, this is mound meadow, and mound meadow is predominantly California airgrass as well as saltgrass. And these are some of the most diverse native coastal prairies in California. A study in 2002 found that Pueblos had higher cover of native plants and fewer exotic species than other coastal prairies in California. And then another survey in 2010 that looked at coastal prairies from Pueblos up to Franklin Point, which is also near Año Nuevo, found that this mound meadow, which is what you see here, had higher species richness compared to other coastal prairies with a total of 41 different species. And finally, we have coastal bluff, and these are the species that cling to the rocky edges of the reserve, and they include deer buckwheat, seaside daisy, golden yarrow, and sea webs. So I used a combination of field observations as well as remote sensing to complete this project. We were really fortunate to have a LIDAR data set for the reserve, and LIDAR stands for light detection and ranging. It's what you see here. It's essentially a very accurate elevation point cloud collected with laser beams from an airplane. And so the Naval Coast Graduate School collected a LIDAR data set for Pueblos in 2013. And at the same time, they collected really high resolution ortho photos. And so I was able to use those in combination with the field data collection to map the plant communities. And as I was mapping, essentially what I did was I walked around Pueblos with a handheld Trimble GPS unit, which is what you see here. And I was contemplating the vegetation and collecting point and polygon data. What that means is essentially I would locate a plant community and circumnavigate that plant community with the GPS unit, and then collect these attributes for each plant, for each of those polygons. And so I was collecting information about which plant community it was, how dense the vegetation was within that site, the average height of the a small location of invasive species. What I would do is take a point location and then record the approximate quantity of individuals that are in that spot. And of course, there were some areas that were inaccessible due to impenetrable stands of poison oak or also really thick ceanothus. So in that case, what I would do is I would collect what I call a checkpoint, which was essentially a single point that still had all the same plant community information, but it would allow me to then use photos later to figure out what the boundaries were, because I couldn't actually physically walk around those boundaries. But I would have all this information connected to a point that I could then transfer over to the polygon that I created in GIS. And for remote sensing, essentially I used remote sensing mostly to map the forest boundary. In addition to the plant communities that I couldn't walk around, I was able to take the LiDAR data set and create what's called a canopy height model. And all that is taking the elevations from the top of the canopy and subtracting the ground elevations, and then you have the elevations of the vegetation. So that's what you see here. And the forest really easily stands out against the lower elevation coastal scrub and prairie areas. And so then I can just manually, in ArcGIS, draw a boundary line around the edge of the forest. And that made mapping in the field a lot simpler because I didn't have to physically walk around the entire forest perimeter. Instead, what I could do is just as I went, record which species I'm seeing so that I figure out what the forest composition was, and I could assign those values to the digitized polygon later. And then, like I said, all the analysis was done in ArcGIS, so I had to combine all of the remote sensing and field data together to create the maps that I'm going to show you now. So this is a map of plant communities in Point Lobos for 2016. So this is the state of the reserve for 2016. And it's sort of a lot to take in, so I'll try to walk you through it. These dark green areas are essentially the forested areas that are predominantly pine, and the lighter green areas are pine and live coastline oak. Along the in the Alamorina cypress grove and along the bluffs there are cypress areas. Dark blue is pure cypress, and this lighter blue is areas where it's cypress mixed with pine. The other dominant plant community was coastal scrub, and that's represented by these kind of blue teal colors. And then grasslands are all these lighter areas. For those of you that like numbers, we have some numbers. Oh, I'm sorry, they're a little small. But so the forested areas throughout the reserve are the Monterey pine. So anywhere that Monterey pine is mixed with cypress or with oak is this percentage. So about 60% of the reserve is covered with Monterey pine, and sometimes mixed with oak and sometimes mixed with cypress. 25% is coastal scrub. Grassland is about 8.8%, and then those pure cypress stands are about 3% of the reserve. Now imagine that we take the forest canopy off, and now we're looking at the understory vegetation. So understory vegetation, the blue areas are shrubs, and I divided them between high shrubs and low shrubs. So the taller shrubs would be things like California lilac and copperberry, and some poison oak sometimes gets that tall as well. And then lower shrubs are monkey flower and blackberry. So those are in blue. The lighter green areas are grasslands. And I was surprised how much grassland and how much open space there was in the forest canopy. The interface between the shrubs and the grasslands are these green patches. And those are mostly Elemis lacus. The blue wild rye likes to grow in with blackberry and monkey flower. So that's mostly what's in those green patches. And then brown are areas that were bare or mostly bare. And here are the numbers. So shrubs are about 60% of the reserve. That's the tall and the small shrubs combined. Grasses were about 20%. Mixed grass and shrub were about 10%. And then bare ground was about 8%. And these, I'm sorry, I should say that these percentages are the percent of the understory vegetation. So 60% of the understory vegetation was shrubs. What the vegetation looks like in the reserve now, we can compare it to those historical maps that I showed you earlier and see how it's changed since 1935. These maps, again, are a lot to take in, so we'll walk through them slowly. This is the extent of coastal scrub only in 1935. And what's important to note is that this grayed out area is to remind us that Hudson Meadow was not part of the reserve in 1935. Mm-hmm. And so this area is not going to be included in any of the acres that I give you for the 1935 extent. So this is coastal scrub in 1935. We can add on to that the 1974 extent, and that's these brown patches. And so it's expanded. Expanded in some areas here, but also notice that it's shrunk in other areas. And then the green is 2016, along with, and then here I have the table for you, so you can see that not including Hudson Meadow in 1935, but the coastal scrub areas expanded and then shrunk a little bit in 2016 since 1974. Now we'll look at Monterey Cypress. This is the 1935 extent. We'll add on top 1974, and you notice it didn't really change that much between 1974 and 1935. And then here's 2016. And what I think is really interesting about this map is that the pure cypress stands are what's in green here. There's a little patch there and a little patch there. And so the pure cypress has actually shrunk. But the extent of Monterey cypress throughout the reserve has grown. And what's happened is that the pine has started to infiltrate some of the pure cypress stands, and the cypress is also expanding into areas that were formerly just pine. Mm-hmm. Here's Monterey pine in 1935. Add on the 1974. And this one's really fun. Are you ready for it? this is 2016. And so the Monterey pine has more than doubled its extent since 1935. And this, the 2016 area represents any area that had pine at all. So it includes areas that were mixed cypress and also mixed red oak. And finally, we'll look at the grassland. This is where it's really important to remember that the Hudson Meadow area was not included in the 1935 study. If we look at 1974, you can see that 1974 Hudson Meadow was entirely grassland, so we can reasonably assume that the 1935 was also grassland. And then in 2016, our grasslands have shrunk considerably. The mountain meadows are just a small portion of what they used to be. And the area, again, we have to add about 40 acres to its 1935 number to make it comparable. So we're going from almost 200 acres in 1935 to 32 acres in 2016. And the reason for that is because the Monterey pine and the coastal scrub habitats have expanded. Now we'll move on to the second goal for this internship, which was to map the exotic species throughout the reserve. I mapped about 62 different exotic species. These ones are perennial grasses, Harding grass is a picture here, but this is tall fescue, and this is velvet grass, and Harding grass is another one we have trouble with. This is oxalis, thistle, there are about 7 different species of thistle, this one's Italian thistle, cape ivy, fennel, fireweed, poison hemlock, this is ice plant, this is a little baby campus grass, and this is a picture from Pescadero that shows a mixture of mustard and poison hemlock. So now we'll go through another series of maps that depict where exotic species occur throughout the reserve. So this first map is, there are species that we have present in the reserve that are ranked high by California Invasive Plant Council, or CalIPC. And what that means is that, what that means is that they have severe ecological impacts, and their reproductive biology and other attributes are conducive to really high rates of dispersal and establishment. And many of these species are pretty widespread throughout California. So the species that are ranked high on the CalIPC list that we have in the reserve are cape ivy, which is mostly over here in the northwest portion. English ivy, there are only about 4 locations right here. Campus grass is mostly in the interior. French broom is in Hudson Meadow and along the highway here. And then fennel was entirely limited to Hudson Meadow. The other species that's ranked high by CalIPC is ice plant. And I found 3 different species of ice plant in the reserve. And it's mostly located to the coastal areas. But there are a couple instances in the little and the larger mountain meadow, as well as in Hudson Meadow. because they are so widespread. And so fireweed is one example of that. We have two different species of fireweed, cutleaf fireweed and coastal birdweed. And these plants really like to grow in partial shade, and so you mostly see them growing on the edges of meadows and also along roads and trails. The other species group that was really widespread throughout the reserve was the thistle. And like I said, I mapped seven different species of thistle. And you mostly find thistle in more sunny areas. And so you can see the meadows are particularly hard hit. This is Mount Meadow and Little Mount Meadow. This is Carmelo Meadow and Little Meadow. So they like to be more in the sun. They also grow along the coast and along roadways as well. And poison hemlock, I wanted to show this map because poison hemlock is a species that state park staff have been actively managing in the reserve. And when I surveyed last summer, I could see that the populations that I mapped here had been treated already. They were cut and then herbicided. And I only saw a few different resprouts. And when I was out in the reserve just a couple weeks ago, I noticed that they were really going off. They were, the seedlings had germinated in those locations and they definitely need to be revisited. And I wanted to point this out for two reasons. The first being the importance of mapping during the right time of year for the species that you're interested in. I mapped in the summer because that was the time that we mostly had available. And obviously it was not the right time to map for poison hemlock and also species like oxalis, which are only really visible in the winter and spring. So that's the first point. And then the second point is the importance of going back and looking at the areas that you previously treated to make sure that you got all the species or to do follow-up treatment if necessary. And then this is the last exotic species I want to mention. This one's just fun because it's all the ornamental species that people planted in their garden because they thought they looked pretty. They're the garden escapees. And none of these species had really a significant extent on their own. But when you look at them collectively, they do kind of have a big impact on the reserve. And they're especially concentrated around areas where there are buildings and along the highway there. All right, so now we're going to move on to that third goal for this internship, which was to recommend management strategies to preserve the health and diversity of vegetation throughout the reserve. And we'll do that first by looking at how to manage exotic species. There are many, many different resources available out there to tell you about how to get rid of exotic species and what their life history traits are. And so my goal is to take all of that information and compile it into a format that will be useful for Point Lobo staff. And the strategy that we choose to get rid of these exotic species is really going to depend on the species that we're concerned with, the time of year that we want to do treatments, the extent of the infestation of that species, what resources we have available, and then also the composition of the surrounding plant community. So like I said, there are many strategies for removing weeds. This is just a few. Manual removal generally is considered to require a lot of effort. It's kind of expensive, especially if you have to pay contractors to do it. But it is nice because you can really specifically target only the species that you want to remove. And there's a couple examples of manual removal here. There's a man pulling French broom here with a weed brush, and there's a woman using a hand pick to get rid of herbaceous species. Another strategy is herbicide, and herbicide is generally considered the least expensive option. This man is herbiciding some plants here. The time of year that your herbicide is really important because if you do it at the wrong time of year, you won't kill the plant completely and it'll still be able to flower and reproduce, which kind of defeats the purpose. And then also there's some concern that if the applicator is not careful, there can be overspray that can damage nearby plant communities. And then if you have really large infestations of weeds, you can use methods like brush cutting or mowing, which is what these gentlemen are doing here. Even controlled burns can be used to control weeds. And other methods could be solarizing or grazing. So there are many strategies to get rid of weeds. And I'd argue that Hudson Meadow is a really excellent place to practice these different weed techniques and to do some experiments to see what works and what doesn't, because there are so many weeds within the reserve. And it's a less sensitive habitat than, say, Mount Meadow. So I'm developing this chart, and this is just a little example of it, to try and bring together the information about species that are easily to access. They can be removed by hand before seed dispersal, and they might be follow-up, but there's a lot of examples of really successful eradication of these species. And so I put fireweed and thistle in that list. I know that they are really widespread throughout the reserve, but they're generally along trails and in meadows, which are really easy to get to. So those are plants that could be weeded by volunteers or contractors, depending on what resources are available. French broom and pampas grass are on this list. And they can be really horrible weeds in some places, but the reality in Point Lobos is that they're not that widespread. And so you can get rid of all the adults, all of the adult French broom and pampas grass within a season or two, and then just have to be followed every couple of years to make sure they're not sprouting. The species that are going to require more of a long-term effort include capivy, ice plant, perennial grasses, fennel, and poison hemlock, among others. And these are species that they're either in really difficult to access locations, like ice plant, which likes to grow along the cliffs, or they're just really insidious, and like capivy, they'll resprout if you pull them and leave any of the nodes behind. So they require a much longer-term effort, more oversight by state park staff, and then also, for example, if you get rid of perennial grasses in Pensa Meadow, you're going to be left with essentially a bare patch, and you need to have some strategy for replanting that area pretty quickly to prevent reinvasion. The one strategy for managing weeds that already is in place with state park staff is to use these calendars to give you an idea of what you should be working on for different seasons. And so this is October through January, and they want to focus on ice plant, French broom, and calendar. And I would argue that we can add to this also the treatment method. And so you can have maps that show the season as well as the treatment method for each species, so that we can have contractors go out there and pull multiple species using the same tools that they've been now on the day. This is for February through March, and the amount of weeds that are ready to go in February through March is quite a bit more. So this really highlights the importance of utilizing all the resources that we have efficiently to get rid of the weeds in Point Lobos. And I think that the best way to manage the weed problem is to coordinate efforts between the state park staff and volunteers. There's a really enthusiastic volunteer base, and really a lot of the locations throughout the reserve are accessible and can be managed well. But you have to be able to coordinate between the two. And so you need somebody that can manage the volunteers and also work as a liaison between the state park staff and the Point Lobos Foundation. And then you also need some way to standardize the documentation of the weed control efforts to make sure that you're not duplicating efforts, but also that the location and timing of treatments is recorded. And then there's some follow-up to make sure to see whether the treatments were effective. So not only do we need to consider how to eliminate exotic species throughout the reserve, but we also want to manage for preserving the existing plant habitats within the reserve. The 1979 general plan stated that departmental scientists found higher diversity per unit area than in any other state park unit. And so it's a very special location with several species of rare and endangered plants that is worth protecting and worth spending some time thinking about how to manage those communities properly. And the vegetation management goals from state parks in 2010 for Point Lobos were to manage the vegetation to support a richness of native species, to promote processes that enhance preservation, protection, and restoration of these special plant communities, and to maintain disturbance regimes that support a sustainable population of the species and habitats present. So as I mentioned, there are those three special plant communities, which are of course the Monterey Cypress, the Monterey Pine, and Coastal Prairies, which is what you see here. And the challenge in this site is how to balance these ecological resources so that one plant community is not out-competing the other. And in this case, choosing not to manage this vegetation is going to result in losing these relic coastal prairie habitats and also continued shrinking of the Monterey Cypress stands due to expansion of Monterey Pine Forest. To give you a little example of what that looks like, this is the Mound Meadow and the Little Mound Meadow. And this is I'm showing you the historical extents superimposed upon each other. So the gray is 1935, the brown is 1974, and the individual shrubs that are coming up in the middle of the meadows, and that's what this looks like. And so all of these little triangles are pine saplings, and all of these dots are native shrubs, but they're woody vegetation that's encroaching into these meadows. So you can see that if we don't do anything, it's not going to be very long before we don't have a little brown meadow anymore. And you could argue that the pine forests are a special plant community. They are, and they're worth preserving as well. But they overall reduce diversity. They also increase the fuel load, which is a fire hazard. And you can argue that they're doing really well on their own. And so we want to make sure that we're creating habitat for the coastal prairie, for the pine forest, and the cypress, for them all to coexist well. And the reason that we have coastal prairies in California is because Native Americans burned them to maintain really open landscapes that provided them with seeds and basket tree materials, as well as forage for large game that they hunted. And then once the Europeans displaced Native Americans, they were grazing, so these meadows were maintained because of the presence of grazers. And now we don't have that natural disturbance regime. And we don't know exactly what the historic disturbance regime would be for Point Lobos, but there was a study of fire scars and historical vegetation in a Native American village called Kearsett, which is near Onondaga State Park. And they found that the Native Americans there burned about every 6 to 15 years using low-frequency fires to maintain that open landscape. So if we want to have native coastal prairies and Point Lobos going on into the future, we need to develop some sort of disturbance regime. It could be controlled burns, it could be mowing or brush-cutting vegetation, or even hand-pulling woody vegetation to get rid of the shrubs encroaching on the meadow. But whatever strategy it is, it needs to be performed at somewhat regular intervals to make sure that we're providing habitat for those native grasses. And this is going to require long-term planning and continued effort by state park staff. And again, I'll just put the little idea out there that Hudson Meadows is a really good place to test out different strategies, because there is a lot of woody vegetation there encroaching onto those meadows, and also a lot of potential for restoration in Hudson Meadows. And I'm really grateful for everybody that participated in this, especially for